So the session is getting recorded now. So the initial 15 minutes didn't get recorded. All right. So all these platforms like MailChimp, Constant Contact, these platforms don't let you do the spamming part, guys. When I say spamming, spamming means you have taken name, email address, and all the other details of various people. You have bought this from somewhere and you have added on to your email marketing client. So when I say email marketing client, which is like MailChimp or these email marketing softwares, these are online softwares. If you go ahead and submit across a database which you have purchased from somewhere, then these platforms will never work for you. These platforms, first of all, try to see whether you have genuinely taken out all the details of your customers on your website. It will keep on asking you at several instances that have you taken out the details? I mean, whatever people are you sending the emails, are they really connected to you or not? So just be aware of that. Don't go ahead and do spamming stuff, guys. When I repeat again, spamming is something like if you have not taken permission from someone, but you are going ahead and emailing them across about your offers and about your products and all. It's always good to send across emailers in between Tuesdays and Thursdays, like I said, and afternoon hours works the best. That's what I have been seeing so far. Majorly, emails works best for the e-commerce sites, and with respect to e-commerce sites, it has been seen that good number of sales come during the lunch hours, because majorly people are either busy in their first half or second half, but they do their shopping in between in between 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. And in between 1 p.m. to 4 p.m., Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Thursdays works the best. Excuse me, guys. Any questions, any concerns, please let me know. I would be very happy to help you on that. So another point which I want to make you understand, what sort of words you think we should not be using when it comes down to email marketing in our subject line or in our email creative. Any idea? Any idea if anybody can help me in knowing if you can make any guess? There are certain words which should not be used whenever we are doing an email marketing campaign. Okay, I'll tell you. Words like free promotion, deal, free offers. Absolutely right, Paritosh. Free promotion, deal, offers. These are certain words which are taken by the spam filters. And these spam filters, what they will do if our email is having these words, they will make our email get into the spam folder rather than making them get inside the inbox of the end customer. Now what we will do, a small a walkthrough of one of the campaigns which I have created and the kind of results I have got from that, and then I would go ahead and use my slides along with creating a small campaign. So I'll just do a practical example. I would first like to showcase you certain campaigns which I have created with the help of my MailChimp account. All you need to do is you need to create an account, sign up on MailChimp.com and start creating campaigns. We'll come on to that part also. Okay, let me take care of that part initially. The very first thing which you can do is on the left hand side, you can see create a campaign. Pretty easy stuff. You can go ahead and create a campaign, and there are 3 to 4 different options. The very easy and the most effective one is using certain templates which are there. So you can see the regular campaign being listed out here. Go ahead and select regular campaign. Once you have selected that, it will ask you to which all people do you want to send it to. So I have already created list out here as well. You would see I have created certain list of people whom I want to send across to in my emails to. I have dissected them. If I have got a list of people who are based out of Canada, I have done that. If I have a list of people who have attended one of my conference, let's say it was a conference in the month of August. So I have created that August 2014. I mean, I'm just giving you examples, guys. I can dissect my overall list on the basis of what I want to. Excuse me. Taking an example of, let's say, how Flipkart would do it. Flipkart would dissect its audience, its overall emails, its email list on the basis of festivals also. If somebody has gone onto their website and said that they are looking for products which are which they can gift across on Raksha Bandhan, so they will collect all those email IDs of people who are trying to gather information about products or gifts which they can give on Raksha Bandhan. They will create a list separately by the name of festival Raksha Bandhan, and then they can send a separate emailer to that separate list. You can segregate. I can do it geographically too. Like I said, I want a separate email for people residing in Canada, a separate email for people residing in US, a separate emailer to be shot across to people who are residing in India. How to create the list? I'll first of all start with the list part before we go ahead and create the campaign. On the top, when you see campaigns, templates, list, reports, and automation. So on the top, when you see the list part, go ahead and create a list. It'll ask you to create a list, guys. This is my official, MailChimp account. I would open another one and then show you with an example. So Paritosh says, dissect on the basis of the products purchased by the customer. Absolutely. Yes, that's also what you can do. So there are various ways through which you can dissect the list as well. Okay, so here I go and open another account. The very first thing which I do is to create a list. If I have got list of my subscribers, all right, so I have list of my students who are from a particular institute. I can go ahead and create any number of lists. Let's say I create a list and I name this list as, let's say, Sunday batch 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. All right. So I want to send across emails to all those students who are taking, classes from me on Sundays, 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. And this batch is till August 15th. So the batch which ends on August 15th, I can name it as per my convenience. And whenever people who would be under this list, whenever they will get an email, what should they see in the from section? From whom have they received the email? I can place it over here. Excuse me. If I say that it's up to me, I can write info@dmpaathshala.com. And name, I want them to see DMP as the name in the from section and the email to be info@dmpaathshala. I want to remind them, let's say if people want to know why have they received this email, I would go ahead and leave a message. I would mention a message over here. You are getting online training from DMP on Sundays 3 p.m. So whatever note, whatever message which I want to pass on to my end audience, they can go ahead and still ask that why are they receiving this email. I can mention my organization name, the address. It's pretty simple. I don't think I need to spend a lot of time on this. The country part, the phone number, and do I need notifications on my email ID whenever something happens? When I say something happens, I would need a daily summary that how many people have unsubscribed or subscribed. So, I mean, subscribe cannot happen, but the unsubscription does happen. We would always have an unsubscribe button in the emails which we will be sending out. It's very important, guys. You should take a note of it. Having an unsubscribe link or a button is a total yes. I mean, you cannot send an email to anybody without having an unsubscribe option. this is against the anti-spam laws. When I say anti-spam laws, there is a particular body which looks at certain restrictions on who can send email and who cannot. So whenever someone the notifications part, I can check mark all of them. Whenever there's a subscribe or an unsubscribe, I should get to know them. I go ahead and click on save. And here you see the list name has been created. I can go ahead and submit across names of my subscriber step by step manually also by doing add subscriber and then also going ahead and doing an add a subscriber. Manually, I can add all the names and email address step by step, right? So let's say whatever name I want to post in, full name and all that, and it will keep asking me at every interval that has this person given you the permission to add to the list. You have to, if you do that, then you make sure that definitely it's being done. Otherwise, if somebody will report your email by pressing on an unsubscribe button, I'll show you how an unsubscribe button looks like. I hope most of you would have seen it. In the same email, the Groupon email, you would see an unsubscribe button. It says, if you would like to manage your subscription, click here. And if you always want to unsubscribe. So this is a must, guys. An unsubscribe link should be there for sure. You cannot escape that. This is a must whenever you're doing email marketing. So that is the way you can add subscribers one by one. You can also add subscribers in one shot by having an Excel sheet. You would see import subscriber is another option. You go ahead and click on import subscribers. It'll ask you to upload an Excel sheet or a TXT file. CSV or a TXT file is something. Excuse me. Or you can even copy the, a lot of contacts from your Excel sheet and do that. Are you guys aware of the CSV file? If I open a particular Excel sheet, let's say I'll open an Excel sheet. And within the Excel sheet, I'll show you. Let's say I'm just trying to open any data. Okay. So you would see any data. So there's a lot of data right up here. Okay. I don't want to showcase that since it's getting recorded. So you can see the names are right up here. The email ID is right up here. I can go ahead and save this particular Excel sheet, save as, when I go to save as, and when I go to save as, you can see it says other formats, all right. When I go ahead and click on other formats, I think there's a video lag, guys. I'll just wait for a while. Okay, so what I did, I went on the top, then clicked on save as, and with save as, I went to other formats. When I click on other formats, I have to save my file as a CSV. You would get an option as save as type and CSV. I'm not doing it right now, but you can do it. If you have, let's say, you can try testing out these particular tools, guys, by having your name and maybe 4 to 5 name and email addresses of your friends. Mention your name, your friend's name over here, and their email respective email addresses. Create an Excel sheet, save that across as a CSV. Once you're done with that, go ahead and click on, the list which you have created, click on import subscriber. After clicking on import subscriber, click again on import from a CSV. Go ahead and click on that. It'll ask you to browse, upload that file, and just go ahead and do the upload list part. It will automatically, whether it's 5 or whether it's 2000, all the 2000 list, all the 2000 names and email addresses which you have mentioned in the Excel sheet will get imported out here. I hope it makes sense. That's how you create an email list. You can also create an email list with the help of the, the search engine, or when you do the search engine optimization or run Google Ads, with the ads being running across for your client's website or for your website, you will always have people coming onto your site and subscribing onto the form on your website, they will have put across their name and email address. So you will have a lot of email addresses where you can shoot across emailers. Makes sense? Are we all on the same page? How to create a list and also go ahead and creating a CSV file and then importing it? Can I get a yes or a no from each one of you? So Saurabh says yes. Ashish, Guru Prasad, Santosh says yes. Guru Prasad says, where can we store emails? You can store emails in an Excel sheet. I mean, that's no other options for that. Thanks, Lena. Thanks, Shadab. Thanks, Paritosh. All right. So, Guru Prasad, you can store emails in an Excel sheet. That's something which can be done very easily. Whatever emails you do get and store them in a CSV file. Shrikant, Sunil, I hope you guys are also okay. Let me know in case you have further questions. Yes, says Sunil. Shrikant, after subscription, where email will get stored? All right. So, if you have a website where you have a form where people are coming and subscribing, if you have a developer, your developer can actually set up functionality where your emails are getting stored in a database. And that database can be an Excel sheet. Or you can also use Google Forms. If you guys have ever used Google Forms, this is one of the major, one of the best ways which you can collect information in a form. Let me showcase that. So if you use Google Forms, you can create forms and get that embedded into your website. It's very simple to get the forms which you make, get them on your website. And once you run your paid ads, you will collect all these entries in that within the Google Forms only. So let me enter inside and show you one of the forms which I have rather created recently. Just give me a moment. I'm logging in and just showcasing you the Google Forms functionality. So Guru Prasad says, can we attach MailChimp or any other autoresponder? Absolutely, you can do that. You're absolutely right. I'll just a second. MailChimp can be integrated. Why CSV? Because CSV is the most acceptable extension. You can also use a TXT format, but .xls cannot be done, Santosh, because these particular tools, they don't accept XLS or Word doc or something. They either accept a text format, TXT format, or they can also accept TXT or a CSV. That's it, these two. Okay, so I'm done. I'm just gonna open Google Forms. So in case you want to understand how to create forms and place them across on your website, you can always take help of Google Forms. That's the most user-friendly tool, guys, which you can use. All right, so I had a particular form which was being created. Not really sure what happened to that. Okay, the forms which you save, they get saved in your drive. I'm just opening that. Right, here you go. Okay, so the Google form you can actually use to gather information about your subscriber onto your website. So I was being asked, well, how can you, you know, take details of your customers who are coming onto your website. So you can use either a Google form functionality, or with the Google form functionality, you can store, you can create forms, embed them into your website. The forms will be up there on your website, and then you will get the details of all the people right across who are submitting forms. So let me. All right, so I'm not getting the form right now, guys. Let me just. So the form part. All right, so here's the form, and that's the live form. Okay, that's not the completed version. All right. Yeah, here you go. This is the one which I created. So this is one of the form, guys, which I've already created, and I'm going to embed that into my website also. I can even submit across name and email ID. I can have these kind of stuff. Playing around with Google Forms is pretty easy. I'll just share across the URL where you can go ahead and create them, Google Forms. Okay, I've already done that. Does that answer your question, Santosh? You would need to really go ahead and play around with Google Forms and create forms so that these forms would go ahead and take down, would help you to pull out details of all those people who are coming onto your website. And you will get all the form submissions within an Excel sheet only. Within an Excel sheet, you will get all the details. So once you do that, coming back to MailChimp, guys, it needs a bit of a bit of practice, but how to do that, where to place it. Absolutely. I'll take that part once we'll cover the, the WordPress part with your website. How do you, when you will get your WordPress website, you can embed these forms within your website with the help of an embed plugin. So I'll take that part. Since that's something which have been done with this batch earlier on, the WordPress part, when we did the on-page optimization, we did cover the WordPress part. Similarly, you can see sign up forms are also mentioned over here. You can create forms over here on MailChimp too, and then embed them on your website, guys. So generate HTML forms, right? These are some of the forms that they have also come up with. Facebook form, that was not earlier on. You know, you can build general forms from here and get them embedded into your website. So Santosh, don't get worried. I'll tell you how to get that embedded into your website. All right, so you can create a particular form right up here and get that across onto your website. You can mention the name, whatever things you want to target into your form, make a form accordingly. And that can be placed across on your website. So there's a lot of stuff, guys. I mean, you don't need to get into the depth of all these. If I tell you about the major basics which you should look at, then let me move ahead and tell you the first of all, the major basics and the advanced stuff which you should go ahead with. Once you're done with the list part, you have created the list, imported all the subscriber based which you have got from there, then the next step would be to go ahead and create a campaign, guys. I'm all there to assist you. Don't worry in case something is not getting clear, but things will get clear only if you will play around with these platforms. Whatever we have covered so far with everyone, whether it's a Google search or a pay, you know, display ad or on page or off page, until and unless you don't do them personally, you are not going to get them perfectly. So it's very important you try spending time and do them practically for yourself. So I have gone on to campaigns part. I go ahead and click on create a campaign tab. And the very first one, which is regular campaign. With the regular campaign, let's say if I take the very first one list, which does not have any recipients right now. Let's see whether it allows me. All right, it did allow me. I have selected to send across an campaign, to create a campaign, and that campaign will be sent across to that list, to the new list which I had created, the Sunday batch. And I can name my campaign as, let's say, whatever I want to name it as. So wishing across Happy Independence Day to all those people who are part of my Sunday batch. Let's say I say that, and I mention the email subject line as whatever, wishing Happy Independence, blah, blah. So you guys can go ahead and do that. So it says 120 characters remaining. I always go and suggest you to have 24 to 30 characters subject line, not more than that. You can also get support from, you know, there are plenty of resources which MailChimp provides you on how do you write a good subject lines. So it'll also again tell you not to write things like free deals and all that stuff. So it says subject line researcher. So once I have posted that across, it tells me what would be the best subject line. So there are certain options which this particular tool provides you what you should write. So 2 rating is given to Independence Day or Independence Sale. I can go ahead and play a lot on numerous permutation and combinations, and so no results found for this one. So it says don't use the words in the numerical phrase that contain 3 words. So I can go ahead and use these words. So Independence Sale or Independence Day, this is what it suggests to me. And let's say if I go over the very first one, Independence Day, and whatever subject line I give it, from and the to option. Don't go ahead with all these things, guys. It's a lot of stuff. You can also integrate it with plenty of other things like Salesforce and all the other stuff. Just go further down. You can connect your MailChimp account also to your Twitter and also to your Facebook. If you want whatever emails you are sending through a Facebook account, that same email should be posted across on your should be tweeted across on your Twitter profile automatically, or should be posted across as a Facebook status update on your Facebook page. You can go ahead and do that. I've already linked it. That's why there's so many pages which is being shown. I own these Facebook pages, guys. So if I select one of them, what will happen whenever I shoot across an email, the same content will and the email creator will get posted on these website web pages also. So whether it's Nick Bartla, Yo Creations or what. And also with respect to my Twitter account also. I've not connected that. You can connect it by clicking on this. It'll just ask you for the username and password. That's it. Pretty easy stuff. Once you're done with that, these are certain paid options where you can even create a video of your, it will scan the entire email and the videos would be also scanned across if you have embedded certain videos. I don't want you to get confused with that. Go ahead and click on, so I have a question right now. Okay, so I Guru Prasad says, please share the risk part that can happen in email marketing. Okay, so the risk part, if I talk about Guru Prasad, if we are using database of all those people who have not given permission to us, and we are sending emailers to them, then if they'll report us, if they will mention that this particular email is a spam, then our website can also get banned. Our MailChimp account will definitely get banned. Let's say the risk part, if I talk about, guys, if I have taken database of I've created a list and submitted across 20-25 people within a list, and out of those 25, couple of people just click on unsubscribe button when the email is being sent to them, and then they mention that they have never given permission to this particular person to send across email to them, MailChimp account can get banned for us, and we might have to then open a new MailChimp account. And if this happens again and again, what can happen, that our IP address can get blocked. We will never be able to create MailChimp account from the same place, from the same email address, Guru Prasad. That's the kind of negative effect can happen. Are you getting me? I hope everybody is clear on that part. So the next thing, guys, you can see, once we have gone ahead and do that, we can select for the themes. Ashish, are you able to hear me now? Just wanted to check with you. He was not able to hear me. Probably now also he's not able to hear me. All right. Can't do much. So you can see a lot of email templates right across over here, which you can select on the basis of your overall objective of the campaign. The objective of a campaign is to provide certain wishes, Independence Day wishes. If you have a birthday to wish across, then you have a particular theme for that. Then you have, you have to deliver, share certain, a coupon. If you have a e-commerce website, like the Groupon website, which we have spoken about, you have a certain flyer to spread across, to send that across, any certain products to promote a sale or something, a graduation invite or a high school newsletter. I mean, there are plenty of them if you have an event. So let's say in this case, how to place response button. Okay. So when you say response button, what exactly I couldn't get you, Santosh, if you can let me know. The call to action button, are you talking about? Okay, I'll tell you. So once, let's say, well, first we have to select on a particular theme. Let's say I select a particular theme as, it will get hyperlink, absolutely. So we have to select a theme, and then on the basis of the theme, we can have the call to action. Let's say I go ahead and do this one, the New Year balloons one. Okay, I'm gonna edit this for the I go ahead and click on next. Within this particular theme, I can create the response or the call to action button, and also place across the text. You have to have good, great content, guys. You can see on the right hand side, I have the page functionality. I can change the overall colors also. So if I want to change it, the background color, I can do it accordingly, right? I can change the text color from blue let's say to black or to whatever. So I mean, you can go ahead and do all these changes. Even with respect to this particular image, that can be done. Similarly, for the header point of view, the body part, where you can go ahead and change. So you can edit the images and also the buttons right up over here. So had you been, if you had the e-commerce website, then you could have, you would have selected the e-commerce template, and within the e-commerce templates, all these buttons come automatically. You can just go ahead and edit their text and also the color. So the way you are able to do it right now over with these, you can do it similarly for those as well. So we don't have a button for a birthday wishing template. So these templates are fairly easy to work on. I would request you to, you know, create a dummy account, mention across at least five names and five email addresses, create an Excel sheet and save that as a CSV. Then go ahead and create an, create a list in your MailChimp account, import across your CSV sheet, and once you have imported that, create a campaign with the help of a template. And the template can be anything, whatever you want to, and whether it's an independence or a Rakhi Day celebration or whatever you want to name it. So go ahead and save that. Once you have done with all the content which you have mentioned, you can go ahead and edit that content, edit the content which is right up here as well. You can also place an image in between that, or create a hyperlink also. You can create a hyperlink over here. If you selected this part, you can create a hyperlink and make it link it to someone, some other URL, whether you want to name it, let's say, to abc.com. So whenever someone is going to click on these words, you know, chance at a new beginning, they will go to that particular website. They'll get, shoot it across there. I mean, their browser will open that. So how to place a link on the image? All right, I'll show you that. So let's say if I want to place, this is the image, right? Okay, I'll go up. So let's say if the image is right up here, I go ahead and edit this. You can see the link button right up here, Santosh, right? So you have the image. You can change the image also by clicking on replace. In case you don't do that, you have the same image. You can go ahead and, you know, place the link right up here as well and get the edit thing done. Makes sense. And then you can go ahead and save and close. So this is being hyperlinked now. Any particular text can be hyperlinked, or the image can be hyperlinked. These are certain templates which you can work on, despite of the fact that you don't know web designing. You don't need to be a web designer to work on emailer templates, guys. If you really need way too much customized emails, like the way we have seen with Groupon, then you can definitely can hyperlink website page. Absolutely, you can do that. That's what I did. So you want to hyperlink a website page, either on a text or on a, an image, you can do that. So if, let's say, if I have the same website, I can go ahead and edit. Sorry, edit is changing the overall contrast and all that stuff, or I can crop that. If I go into the link part, I can mention, theimpartshala.com. So I can mention across that. Right, Santosh? Makes sense? Any further? Does that answer your question? So you can hyperlink a particular. All right. So that is something which you guys can go ahead and do. I'm not going to spend more time on this. Go ahead and click on save and close. Next part. And then it'll ask you whether you want to send. So it's showing cross because I don't have anyone right now, any recipients in my list. Otherwise, it would have shown a tick mark signal. So, you know, all the things would have been perfectly well, and I would have got an option right up here, a button with a send or a schedule. If you will see with the schedule, what happens, I don't want to send my email today. I have created it today. It's 19th of July, and I want this Independence Day emailer to be sent across on 15th of August only, right, in the morning, or 14th of August. So I can click on schedule button. It would have asked me on which particular date, at what time do you want to send it to. I would have selected 14th of August and to be sent across at 3 p.m. Right? I can even schedule that. And if I want to send it across right now, I can go ahead and click on send and would have done that across. Make sense, guys? That's a simple process of doing creating an email list, creating an email template, a campaign with the help of a template. Once that's being done, then the most important point which comes is, I'm just exiting from here. The most important point which comes over here is checking the, you know, measuring how the entire campaign went. So I told you two couple of things which one should look at when it comes down to checking the success and non-success of a particular campaign. What was that? Do you remember those two stuff? Those two measurability part? So what I would do, I would go ahead and click on reports. Absolutely, Santosh, that's right. The open. And what was the other part? And the click. Right. So the open rate and the click rate. If you would see, I have gone on the top on the reports section, and in the reports section, if I, let's say, go for a particular campaign, you would see it was, this particular campaign was being sent across to 3,519 people, and out of those, 20.9% people have opened my emailer, and nobody actually clicked on the emailer, which is sad, which is not that good. Similarly, for the other campaign, 94 people received, I mean, the email campaign, this one, second one, was being sent to 94 people. 31 people opened, which is 34.4%, which is a great number in terms of open rate, but lower on the click side. If my subject line and my from is attractive, and if I have sent it on the at a good time, then I can achieve good open rate. Good open rate can be achieved with the help of the good timing. I mean, when I say good timing, it means the time period when it is being sent. And also, a good open rate also depends on the subject line and the from. From subject line and the time part is dependent upon the open, these three factors affect the open rate. And after the open rate, good open rate is achieved, how do we make sure the good click rate is also achieved? That is with the help of the email creative. If the email creative is catchy enough, if you can see with this particular email, 6.66% click rate, which is a good number. So 24.1% people opened it and 6.6% people clicked onto it. This is 6.6% of this total, and this is 24.1% of the total subscriber base. So I hope you're getting it. Similarly, if I go further down, then you would see another campaign which has got four, which was being sent to 452 subscriber, where 227 people opened it, which is 51%, phenomenally well, and 82 people clicked, which is almost close to 18.4% click rate. This is a very amazing. So you can always make a measurement. You can always compare one of your campaign with the other campaigns and then decide which one has performed better. There is no benchmarking which I can say has been done. Whether this is a good particular percentage or this is a bad particular percentage. All in all, a lot depends on industry to industry. So what you can do, you can just keep sending across emailers and compare your one campaign with the other campaign. Right, guys? So that's the reporting part, list part, templates part. Templates are those same templates which you go ahead and select, which I've already shown you, like you had for the e-commerce, non-e-commerce, event-based. And then you have the campaigns part where you go ahead and submit across details that your particular campaign name, a campaign would be sent across to which particular list, what is the name of your campaign, your company's name, and it also asks you for the from and the to email, which will come when this campaign would be sent across. pretty easy stuff. Email marketing is not that difficult, guys. A lot depends on the open rate and the click rate. And don't go with the automation part. That's way too lengthy in process. It's like setting rules and whatnot, and it's a paid feature also. So that is actually not a part of email marketing. It's a very excessive, I would say, inbound, advanced level of inbound and email marketing part. So that's what generally comes into the email marketing. I'll open my slide and show you what I had to present. It's the same stuff, guys, which I've spoken so far. All right, so what are the best practices for email marketing? I've already shared the link for this particular, for this particular presentation. So the very first step, whenever you're doing email marketing, the very first step is obviously to decide on the objective of your campaign, what sort of campaigns you want to run, whether it's wishing across certain festivals on certain festivals, or say showcasing certain offers, promotional offers you're coming up with, and then start choosing across an email marketing provider. So like MailChimp, we also mentioned Aweber or Vertical Response or Constant Contact, some of those. There are lot many email marketers, email marketing providers in the internet world. They have different features altogether and different costs associated to them. I have showcased you the most highly liked and widely used one. So wherever you go, if you tell them that you've got hands on to MailChimp, everybody will appreciate that. So, but do make sure that if your database increases, then you should look at some more options also, just like Constant Contact. I told you, you can try using all the other ones. There's a thin line of difference between all of these email marketing providers, hardly much of a difference, guys. That is first step. Once you have decided on the email marketing platform, start building your database. Building a database, you can't run an email campaign till the time you don't have a database. So having a database takes a lot of time, and you would probably need to indulge into some of the other kind of marketing activity beforehand. Even if you're doing an offline marketing, people might call you up. You can start asking them their email IDs. Even if you have, let's say, an offline business channel, offline business model, where people come onto your store or to your restaurant or whatever, then you can suggest your client, or if it's yours, then you can start taking email IDs of all those people who are coming to your store, to your particular local business. And once you collect all that data, you can send them across emailers at regular intervals. So just highlighting this particular word line, guys, never ever purchase email database. They will never work. They will always create problems. They will ban your IP addresses and ban your, these are black hat techniques. One should never indulge into all these kind of things. So grow your data organically, get favoritism for your particular, business, and get that list increasing on day-to-day basis. Keep on sending them emailers regularly to your database. That's another thing, just to be in touch with them, and organize your email contacts. Like I said, dissect your email contacts on the basis of certain features which you want. In case you want to dissect them on the basis of the geographic location or the time of the year or whatever, that's all up to you. Make sure you dissect and send them targeted messages. The same example which I took, where I would have a different email for all those subscriber base who are from Canada, a different targeted list for subscriber base who are based out of India. I can surely send them emailers according to what they are being, the entire list is being created. Right? Makes sense, guys. That's about organizing and dissecting. And then you have to decide on the objective. I spoke about the objective earlier on, but once you have concluded onto the email contacts part, the database you have got in place, you've got the email marketing provider, next thing is to look at the objective of your email marketing campaign. Is it just to promote across your promotional offers and get some buzz around it? or to get some leads or sales out of it? Or is it to gather much more customer testimonials or whatever? I mean, they can be, or to gather sales, more downloads or more signups. So for every website, there are different objectives altogether. An e-commerce website will have a different objective as compared to a website which is a non-e-commerce based. Every website will have their own different objectives. So go ahead and create your objective. Keep your objective in mind before creating the campaign. Once that's being clear, then on the basis of your objective, you can start building your email creative. And your email creative, a lot depends. Email creative has to match with the objective, and objective has to, and both the things has to match with the template which you're choosing. Try to make it as simple as you can. When I say simple, if it's a B2B, simple is the best thing. If it's a B2C, then probably, flowery colors, very attractive colors is something which you should go for. And have more of images than of text, guys. It's being always recommended that images propels much better conversions. 80 to 20% ratio is something which is being liked in the industry and also advised and recommended. 80% of images and 20% of text. We also saw that in one of the emailers by Groupon, right? Once you have done that, go ahead, get that creative and just get ready to send that across. Ensure your content is perfect. Before you send, the sixth step is to make sure that your images are not of low resolution. The content which you're posting across is also, is also not copied across. Make sure you're not using the words like free, buy now, deals, shop, all that stuff. And also to make sure that your content is different and interesting, tailor your content as per the database segmentation. So let's say if it's a Canadian one, then probably you might have to use words according to that. And also make sure your call to actions are there. I hope you remember the call to action part: buy now, click now, order now, call now, whatever. So no grammatical sparer, content not being copied from somewhere. Also making sure that you have something attractive to offer. Avoid words like free, buy now, since they are always, spam filters actually use these words and make them part of the spam. Instead of your email landing into the inbox, they will land into the spam whenever these words are being used. So Guru Prasad says, is there any standard or for text format and size of the text? These templates have the standard formats, Guru Prasad, which we have used. So that if you would see the image size or the text size, the text style, these templates all have that from the design perspective. But if you talk to me in terms of the text perspective, what words to not to be used, these are the words. You can always use those. Check out some of the good emailers which you get. You can learn from them also. But otherwise, never use these words which always feel like as if they are spam. And never ever go ahead and copy stuff. All right, so we have Siddharth who says, hi team, this is Siddharth, how can start? All right, so Siddharth, you have probably joined in a bit late. So I'm really sorry, I think you are not able to hear us as well. All right. So, okay, that was the sixth step. And the number seven step was the tracking stuff. So we have already spoken about that, that how do we go ahead and measure? All right, so even Shashank has joined late, no problem. But Shashank, you can hear us, right? I know that. So with respect to track results, it's always better to monitor across the open rates and the click rate. Open rate and the click rate, that's very important. Low open rates and low click rates is something which suggests that there are a lot of improvements which are needed in your email message or your call to actions. Low or maybe something is wrong with your also the timings on which you are sending. So keep experimenting them. It's very important to keep experimenting as per your business as per your client's business, because there is no strict answer. There's no definite right answer to which applies to every kind of every situation, guys. For every situation, there's a different, there will always be a some or the other answer which will keep differentiating. So the idea is to keep doing the hit and trial method, keep using the hit and trial method, and also apply all these techniques which I have just mentioned. So, right, that's what the eighth step says: review, learn, and adapt. Keep learning from your campaigns. So always benchmark your best performing campaigns. And when you benchmark your best performing campaigns, you try to learn from your best performing campaigns and keep repeating them. Since it says one shoe doesn't fit all, for every situation, you will always have different kind of stuff which you should apply. So that's the rate. So keep improving your open rate and click rate, like the way you by playing around with the content and also the images and all that stuff. The images, call to action, the written content, and also different themes altogether, guys. That's all. I mean, this is what I have from the email marketing, guys. There's not much which needs to be spoken about in terms of email marketing. And in case you have further more questions for me, please go ahead and ask me. I'll be more than happy to assist you. So I'm going to just take a pause for a couple of minutes and I'm going to wait for your questions. I'll also share the links to the presentation I've shared and also links to the videos which I keep uploading. And today's video will also get uploaded on the YouTube channel I have. I know we have covered a lot of things half an hour early, but I'm just going to take more questions and then we'll go from there. We'll move from there. Any questions, guys? I know it's a lot of practice which is needed with respect to all these things. Okay, so I'm sharing the links to all the presentations and the PDFs which I recommend. Okay, there are questions, I think. How to check results through Google Analytics, says Santosh. Okay. And how to check results through... Okay, oh, you have mentioned that a couple of times. Okay. So we can device target... Saurav says we can do device targeting by using this. Okay, first of all, talking about Google Analytics, Santosh, absolutely, you can connect your MailChimp account with Google Analytics too. When you are sending these emailers, they do have an option of connecting your Google Analytics tracking. You can see right up here. It will just ask you for a certain tag, and I'll take a certain session for Google Analytics where I'll tell you. You can place that across in your Google Analytics, create an just a sec, I'll open that part. It gets connected, and within your Google Analytics, I'll show you how do you get to see that. Let's say for a certain website, if I want to check how much traffic have I got with the help of a particular email marketing campaign, I go into the acquisition part, and within the acquisition, I go into all traffic, and within all traffic, I go into the channels part. You would see the email marketing has given just 4 clicks, whereas social media marketing 441, referral marketing is 2369. Direct being, people coming onto my website directly is this much. And through SEO, it's been this much. This is something which can be done. And Saurav says, can we do device targeting by using this? That's for the paid campaigns. With respect to email marketing, we don't have an option, Saurav, at present, where we can say that anybody who's opening their email on the phone should get our email push. Should get to see our email promotional emailer. or anybody who's who's opening an emailer from a desktop should not get to see an emailer. That cannot happen. So with Google AdWords that can happen, Saurabh, but with respect to email marketing it cannot. And we'll have a session on Google Analytics also where I will tell you how do you configure UTM tagging. So Guru Prasad says I'm asking a little bit out of the subject, how to do keyword research for video to upload in YouTube, what should add in tags. Okay, you would definitely need to recommend. Okay, this is out of the topic, which is absolutely fine, Guru Prasad, no problem. Google Keyword Planner tool is something which you should be using, Guru Prasad, to check how many people are, how many people have used this keyword as one of their search terms in the Google search box. So average number of searches, I'll just showcase it to you. Google Keyword Planner tool, it tells you both the things. Google Keyword Planner. Right. So whenever you have to, this is going to be covered, Guru Prasad, when we will also do on SEO with you, but not a problem. I'm answering this right now. You can go ahead and use Google Keyword Planner tool. Try to mention some of the base keywords which you think are related to what you are submitting across. When I say base keywords, some of the primary keywords which you can think of, mention those keywords within the Keyword Planner tool and it will give you a lot of list of keywords. You know, a lot of keywords, permutation, combination of a lot of keywords which people type in. Average searches and competition for every keyword would be defined over there. Saurabh says use keywords which average searches are high and competition is low. Absolutely right. Saurabh has answered that. So once you use that, you can submit across a base keyword over here, the landing page, let's say your video page being there, Guru Prasad, and your product category you can mention, and go ahead and do a get idea stuff. I guess it will be better when I would attend Google Analytics class. Absolutely, Santosh. Yeah, it will. So let me take example of a particular video. Can you try running this, Guru Prasad, on your own and then get to see that? Or let me try doing that. So if I type in SEO, let's say, I'm just giving you an example. I welcome all the questions. Please go ahead and ask your questions. And let's say this is the landing page. Let's say I'm taking an example. All right. So that's the homepage of my website. I've selected a keyword, learn SEO. All right. And the product category I have to select, let's say internet and telecom. I go ahead and select internet. Search engines. All right. Can select URL of video. All right. So let's say if I select a URL of a particular video. Even if you don't select URL of a particular video, or if you even keep it blank, then also it will work. All right. It will now go ahead and click on get ideas. It'll show you a lot of ideas right up here. Keyword ideas, select on that. Okay, here you go with the results. Can you see so many keywords? And as Saurabh also mentioned, go for those keywords which have low competition. You know, competition is right up here. And good average monthly searches. High monthly searches and low competition. But let's say in this case, so Shashank says, will the keywords be fine if we select low competition and high searches, or are there any other basis on which we select keywords? This is the very first primary criteria for selecting keywords, whether it's Shashank, Guru Prasad, Santosh, for each and everyone. The very first criteria is to select those keywords which have low competition and high searches. Let's say most of the keywords which you're getting are of same competition. Just to give you an example, you have a list of these three keywords. Now, out of these three, if you have to select one, you will probably go for this one because this keyword has got 40 searches and low competition. All three have low searches, but out of these three, good number of average monthly searches is with this one. But once you select that, the second criteria is also to see whether this pertains, whether this is relevant to your business or to your business or not as well. So if I am teaching SEO, I have to see easy search engine something which is not at all targeted for me, right? So very first thing is to check at the competition and searches, but number two is to also check from the relevancy point of view. So will those keywords surely rank? It's not about surely ranking. It's all about getting maximum mileage and getting these keywords ranked easily. These keywords will rank easily and will give us much more benefits. That's the only reason why we go ahead with low competition and high searches, guys. Makes sense? I can go ahead and change. Let's say if I delete the landing page, maybe I might get more options. I go ahead and click on get ideas. So Saurav says, if we would select high competition keyword, then it's very difficult to get ranking in search engines. Absolutely. It's always better to go ahead and select the low competitive keywords and get ranking for them in the initial space. Now I have deleted the landing page and it's showing me some more options, guys. You can see low. There's plenty of keywords with low competition, right? So 11 keywords, the same number of keywords are there. There are three keywords with medium competition. I would go ahead and select the very first one. But after having a look at this, I want to make sure that this particular keyword pertains to my business or not. The relevancy is there. Free search engine, not really. So I mean, you have to see from the relevancy point of view also, right? Santosh says, please tell me what's the next step once we choose the right keyword. Okay, once we choose the right keyword, Santosh, that's something which we've already done in this batch, which was on page and off page. So you would be doing this in your batch as well. So it's a longer topic. I would not be able to take it again. I do have shared with you the links of all the videos. So you can, in case you are in hurry, you can also see these videos. So yours is a Monday batch. So the Monday batch videos are going to be uploaded here and the Sunday batch videos are uploaded over here. So these are the Sunday batch videos, guys. Yeah, no problem. I mean, you will definitely get to see them. I'm sharing across the list the channels of the recorded videos. And this is for the Monday one. All right, so I've shared the Sunday and the Monday batch both. I'm going to come up with a new batch also later on. So all of you are invited to all the couple of batches, both the batches which I have, in case you want to revise in something, that's perfectly fine. And I have a whole list of other videos also, wherever you want to go ahead and have a look. Right, so how was the overall session, guys? Was it helpful? I know it was we completed a bit early. I want to make sure that I can answer all your other questions as well. Anything else you want me to cover right now, or you have? Very good, say Saurabh. Thanks. I have a small request for you guys. If you can share your experiences over here. So I have just implemented this technique. I want you to let me know a small feedback form. I've shared this. If you can submit across your rate the today's session, that'll be really helpful for me to. And also let me know what all improvements do you want from these sessions. A room for improvement is always there. I also try to keep learning. I try to keep learning from each and every session. I'll try to improve them. So how to download the note from the links. When you say the notes, you mean the SlideShare notes? These slides are easily downloadable. You just need to create an account, Santosh, and then you will always have the option of downloading them. You see the download button right up here, Santosh? You see the download button? You just need to create an account on slideshare.net and you will always have an option of downloading. All right. So, guys, I've shared the feedback link with you. Please, if you can help me with your feedback being submitted across there. Once done, please let me know. Once you're done with the feedback, please, on the chat box, in the chat box, if you can let me know. Okay, so Lina says this form doesn't ask your name or email. Yeah, right. I have forgotten to punch across the name. All right, I'm so sorry. I'm gonna keep that. Oh yes, we decided that we want to keep it. Okay, that's a deliberate attempt, Lina. This recalls me, because if somebody, maybe it take my signed Gmail. No, even if you don't do that, let's say somebody wants to mention a very critical viewpoint and doesn't want to disclose his or her name, then it becomes sense for them. So I'll create a name in an email, but would not keep them as a required field, a necessary field. So thanks for the suggestion. But we did that deliberately so that if somebody wants to mention a very critical one and doesn't want to share his or her name, then that can happen. So Sunil, Shashank, Shadab, Saurabh, Santosh, Lina, and Guru Prasad. Once you're done, you can let me know. And that tomorrow also we have a session, and tomorrow's topic. Okay, thanks, Saurabh. Tomorrow's topic is Google search. What do you say? Yeah, Google search ads we are covering. And 8:30 to 10:30 we are doing that. That's the second batch. In case anybody who's interested, the same login GoToMeeting details would work. In case you want to attend that, 8:30 tomorrow, which is Monday, 8:30 in the evening. 8:30 in the evening, we are going to be doing it. All right. Thanks, Saurabh. Thanks, Santosh. Thanks, Guru Prasad. Thanks a lot, Sunil. All right, I hope everybody has filled up. I've created a new account for tomorrow's class. All right, that's great, Santosh. Thank you so much. Can you tell me how to use conversion tracking tool in AdWords? All right, sure. I can take that right now. So let me go into the AdWords account. So I have a question right now, how to use conversion tracking tool. I'm opening up an AdWords account. So I'm opening one of my AdWords account and then just going to show you. Yeah, absolutely right, Santosh. Santosh asked me, AdWords account is different from Keyword Planner. Yes, they both are different, but you can access Keyword Planner tool even from the AdWords account, Santosh. If you see right up on the top in an AdWords account, you have the tools button. When you click on tools button, you can access Keyword Planner tool from here as well. Santosh, you can access Keyword Planner. Majorly, the Keyword Planner tool is made up for Google AdWords only. All right. So they both are different, but you can access them since they are linked from this particular place. But majorly use the AdWords tool, sorry, the Keyword Planner tool for the AdWords only. All right. So let's say I have to create a conversion, okay, for one of my campaign which I'm running. And the conversion happens whenever there is a form submission. Okay. After submitting a form, a thank you page opens up. Let's say I have got a page where I can show you that. I use a particular platform called InstaPage for creating my landing pages. You can also get, try this particular one, InstaPage, for creating landing pages. I'm just showcasing you some of the landing pages which I use. So let's say, okay, this is one of my landing page, let's say, and I then have a thank you page also, which I have set up. Guru Prasad says, can we create ad for Bing and Yahoo? Absolutely. For Bing and Yahoo, how does it work? Once you have created ad for Google AdWords, then automatically things can be imported onto the Bing platform also, Guru Prasad. Just try creating a Bing account. Once you're done with the Google account, try creating a Bing account. It will straight away give you an option of importing all your campaigns and ads. Importing all your campaigns and ads from Google to the Bing account. All right. So this is the thank you page. I'm going to publish this. Just a sec, guys. All right, you see one of the landing pages which I have right now is this. I want whenever I run advertisement for this particular web page, and whenever someone submits across their name, phone number, and their email address, and clicks across on get course details, I want that particular form submission to be counted as a conversion. All right, whenever someone clicks on that, a thank you page should come up. Okay. Whenever a thank you page comes up, a conversion should be recorded. Right now, the thank you page is not being configured. I'll just configure that. And whenever a form gets submitted, a conversion should happen. How I'm going to set that up? By going onto the top on the tools option, you have the conversion tab right up here. All right. Click on the conversions tab. Once you click on the conversions tab, it will ask you, how do you want to track the conversions part? I've already created certain conversions. Let's say if I do want to create, I clicked on plus conversions and I want to track, with the help of a particular website, I go ahead and click on the very first one, guys. I'm not doing a checking conversions for an app or a phone call. I click on select, mention form submission conversion, all right, and I can give a particular value to it. I can assign a value. Whenever it happens, I can assign a value of, let's say, a 10 rupees to it. That's up to me. Can we track phone numbers? So whenever there's a phone call, it can be tracked, but it has a limited functionality, sort of. So the number of counts, I want all the conversions to be counted as a conversion, or I just want unique. Guru Prasad says, are paying 10 to Google? I couldn't understand your question, Guru Prasad. Can you be a bit more descriptive? Are paying 10 to Google? If I want all my conversions, all my form submissions, so if one person submits a particular form three times, they all would be counted as three submissions, or I want all the three form submissions from same IP address to be counted as one. If I say unique, all three submissions from one particular user should be counted as one. I can do unique. I want to check conversions for every 90 days. After 90 days, it would be vanished. अरे यार ये इंटरनेट बंद करके चला गया ऊपर ये यहीं से बंद करके चला गया पता चल गया उसको भेजियो भेज दे उसको अरे क्या कह रहा है सुमन पता नहीं अरे यार मैं उसको कर रहा हूँ सुमन को क्या कहना चाह रहा है आप उसको बोल दो हाँ जी सुमन मैं अभी यार 15 मिनट की मेरी क्लास और रहेगी 5 बजे तक
तो मैं यहाँ पे आपको जो दो मेरे पास चेक है और एक 4000 रुपए का कैश है मैं किसी को दे देता हूँ तो
मैं उसको हाँ मैं मेड को भिजवा देता हूँ मैं भिजवा देता हूँ
अच्छा
अच्छा मैं आता हूँ ओके
तो अभी आपसे